A very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. May I please request all our guests at the back end of the hall to take a seat. We are all set to begin this evening, and may I humbly remind all our guests to please put their cell phones in the silent mode for the duration of the event. Once again, a very good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Dun & Bradstreet's Corporate Awards and Top 500 Companies 2019. I'm Isha Bhalla, your MC for the evening. I'm pleased to inform you that this will be the first time Dun & Bradstreet Corporate Awards is being streamed live on social media platforms. It's the time that the world gets to know about the torchbearers of the Indian economy and what they look like. You can now watch the Dun & Bradstreet Corporate Awards 2019 online on Facebook at www.facebook.com Dun & Bradstreet India. You can also watch us live on Twitter at www.twitter.com/DNB India. I'd like to welcome all those of you watching us online. Your opinions and experience count, which is why I'd like to request all of you that while sharing your views on social media, please use our hashtag DNB Corp Awards. Well, the creme de la creme of the corporate world is here tonight, and we are gathered to honor the true heroes of Stars of India Inc., the best performing companies whose profiles have been listed in the 19th edition of Dun & Bradstreet's premier publication, India's Top 500 Companies. Along with the publications released this evening, we will also be recognizing the achievements of Indian corporates across various industries, both from the private and public sector. Ladies and gentlemen, just being in this room is truly an honor. I look around and I see captains of industry coming to mind. All of you represent the very best of the corporate world, and I salute you all. May I request all of you to please put your hands together for yourselves, for colleagues and leaders around. A round of applause, please. Well, before we begin formally, I'd like to take a moment to thank our partner for making today's event possible. I'd like to thank our presenting partner, LIC of India, our DIAS partner, IDFC First Bank, our principal partner, First Abu Dhabi Bank. I'd also like to thank our co-partners, Indian School of Business, SAP Concur, UPL, along with our printing partners, Brother International India. I'd like to thank our general insurance partner, the New India Assurance Company, our workspace partner, WeWork India Management. I'd also like to thank our automobile partner, Mahindra & Mahindra, our real estate partner, Sumatra Infracom. I'd like to thank our exclusive television partner, Business Television India. I'm sure all of you know about Dun & Bradstreet, but to tell you more, we are, and so very proud of the fact that we are the largest global commercial database covering hundreds of millions of companies and making sure that we are record breakers. It is a global leader in commercial data, and this data is mined to generate the valuable statistics and business insights. Dun & Bradstreet has been operating in India since 1995. The data that it collects and analyzes helps lead to identification of the nation's top 500 companies across different sectors, and we've been doing that from 1997. With its long experience and expertise in data mining, Dun & Bradstreet publications, particularly this one, serves as a barometer for the Indian economy. And this is going to be an evening that we will mark as a very special one in your presence. For now, may I request all of you to please put your hands together as I welcome on stage our dignitaries. We are honored by the presence of none other than Dr. Krishnamurthy Subramaniam, Chief Economy Advisor to the Government of India. May I request all of you to please welcome him along with Mr. Manish Sinha, Managing Director at Dun & Bradstreet India, and of course, Mr. V. Vaidyanathan, Managing Director and CEO, IDFC First Bank. I'd like to request our dignitaries to please join us on the dais, along with a round of applause from our audience. Welcome, gentlemen, and I thank you for joining us. Ladies and gentlemen, now to address you all, I'm about to welcome on stage, and right here is a leader par excellence. Mr. Manish Sinha has been a thorough leader all through his working journey. Prior to joining Dun & Bradstreet, he was the CEO and India country head at Equifax, responsible for the bureau and analytics businesses in the country. Before that, he was with HSBC India in their retail banking business, first as the head of consumer assets and then as the head of customer value management. Earlier, he has also worked in mergers and acquisitions department for globally renowned consultancies in McKinsey & Company and Arthur Andersen. Mr. Sinha was academically prepared for his illustrious career with an MBA from IIM Calcutta and a BTech from IIT Kanpur. Without further ado, may I request all of you to please put your hands together for the man who leads and is the perfect host for the evening. A round of applause for Mr. Manish Sinha.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. It is an honor to welcome you all to this evening. Thank you for being here. On behalf of Dun & Bradstreet and on behalf of everyone here, I'd also like to thank profusely my colleagues at the dais, Dr. Subramanian, who has the small matter of attending to his various government departments and government responsibilities, and Mr. Vaidyanathan, who has the small matter of completing the merger of two of the largest financial institutions in recent times that have come up. Thank you, gentlemen. It's a privilege to have you here. It is my privilege to give a little bit of context to the Top 500 event. Many years before corporate awards became as common as they are now, and many years before company league tables in India became as common as they are now, Dun & Bradstreet launched its Top 500 publication, followed closely after by the Top 500 corporate awards, which you are about to attend. This year is the 19th year of our publication and the 13th year of the awards. By way of context, I'd actually like to talk a little bit about where the top 500 companies that are honored here actually sit within our economy. So if you look at the overall GDP of the country, if you take away the part of our GDP that is the government, the bureaucracy, the defense, and the farming side of it, about 80% of the GDP comes out of the spending of approximately 81 million entities in the country. This 81 million entities consists of, obviously, at the top end, the 500 entities that we're here to honor. So roughly one out of approximately 1.5 lakh entities represent about one out of every 4 rupees that come out of that constitute the GDP. So the top 500 entities are actually pretty significant in the economy. If I just put it into context, the Indian economy from a GDP point of view is approximately the fifth. We are sandwiched between Germany and the UK. If the top 500 entities were a separate country by itself, it would be about the 25th from a GDP point of view, sandwiched somewhere between Belgium and Thailand. And growing at the rate that you are, it'll be approximately the 10th by 2030. So from a significance point of view, clearly the top 500 companies are actually pretty significant. That's the good thing, right? So what's the other side of the story? How competitive are the top 500 companies? As I said, we've been tracking the top 500 companies for almost 2 decades now. And what I want to do is I want to just start with the cohort of the top 500 that actually existed in the year 2000. So if you look at the trajectory followed by the 500 companies in the year 2000, and you track what happened to their membership of the elite club, as it were, within 24 months, that 500 had dropped to 400. So about 100 of them had actually moved out of the top 500, right? In about 12 years' time, that is by 2012, we were down to less than half the 500 that existed in the year 2000. So it's not an easy membership to retain, right? And this cohort is very representative of the cohorts that followed. So we've done a similar analysis for the cohort that existed in the year 2005. We've done a similar analysis for the cohort that existed in 2010. And what you'll see is that the lines that are, you know, the lines are pretty parallel. It's clearly not an easy place to compete with domestically, right? So how do we compare internationally? So what we've done is we've taken a similar kind of exercise and applied it to the Global 500, the Fortune Global 500, and followed a similar kind of approach. So we've looked at the 500 in the year 2005 and then in five-year intervals. And we've grouped those companies by country. So if you take a look at where the contributions for the Global 500 came across the countries, not surprisingly, in the year 2000, the U.S. was very, very dominant. It remains the most, the largest contributor. It used to be about 176 in terms of number of entrants into the Global 500. It's still pretty large at 126. But as you look at how some of the other economies, and I want to point mainly to China, how Chinese entities have grown over that time period, China has gone from something like 16 contributors into the Global 500 into 111. It's a very, very close second to the US and way ahead of the number three in terms of the countries that contribute into the Fortune Global 500. In that time, India has gone from about 5 to 7. So actually not done too well. Now why is that and what needs to change? We looked at a lot of research done by the World Bank, the OECD, the CMIE, obviously Dun & Bradstreet research. We look into our own database. As you know, all of these companies, not just the 500, not just the Fortune 500, but all of these are part of the Dun & Bradstreet database. We look at how they're growing. We look at who they're buying from, what strategies they're following. So we look at our 300 million entities on our database, and we add to that the research that our economist team does. And where we come out with is three big groups of things that directly affect the competitiveness of the large companies in the economies. And those three are pretty obvious. What we've tried to do is to actually quantify some kind of an index for each of those and link it to what's happening in the other countries. So the three things that really help make these companies in these countries much more competitive than in India are, firstly, a very high culture of entrepreneurship. Secondly, a metric that has that I want to talk about presently, which is the percentage of what's known as high growth firms in these countries. And I'll talk about why that's important. And thirdly, just the strength of institutions. So if I take them in turn, the first of those is what we call the entrepreneurship index in these countries and the link to GDP. There is an S curve that links these two metrics, right? So to begin with, small levels of entrepreneurship lead to very high improvements in the GDP per capita. You then get to a point where you need to break through to drive the same level of GDP per capita, you need to have a much higher increase in the index, and then you get to what looks like the plateau of the S curve. But basically, again, small levels of entrepreneurship index improvement lead to significant improvements in the GDP per capita. So if you now look at where are the countries on this S curve, what you find is that India is at the bottom left of the chart. We haven't yet begun to even travel the distance for the lower end of the plateau. China is already beginning to reach that inflection point. And then, of course, you have the very rich countries that are at the plateau end of it. So the first part of it, clearly from a country point of view, is to get to that point and come up this curve where the countries are. What's good to see is that even within the cluster of countries at the bottom left, India is at the higher end. So the entrepreneurship index that is defined by the World Bank is actually something that we are already far up on. We just need to move further right and then further up again. The second metric is an interesting one. It's not the most intuitive. It is a metric introduced by the OECD and the World Bank. And before I show you what it is, it's what they refer to as the high growth companies. And they define that metric as the percentage of companies in that economy that are what they call high growth companies, which are in turn defined as 3 consecutive years of more than 20% growth. Now that's an interesting one. It is 20, 20, and 20. And they say that that is more valuable, for instance, than 40, 50, and 10. Because the theory is that this kind of number and that kind of a period of sustained growth is directly linked to the speed with which employment and productivity gets increased. So if you identify that metric for India and the other countries, what you see is a comparison of countries in, and we've grouped it by developed and emerging economies. Not surprisingly, the developed economies have lower percentage of high growth firms, mostly because a lot of the growth has already happened in those companies. There are still tremendous companies that are driving tremendous levels of growth. But in terms of number of such companies, there are fewer, right? If you look at the right side, you have the emerging economies. And again, whilst they are much higher than the developed economies, in mathematical terms, they're about 2 to 3 times. Now, India was a part of that research. The Dun & Bradstreet team extended that research a little bit to see roughly where India actually sits. And what you'll see is actually we don't look much better than the percentage of high growth companies that are a part of the developed economies. And we are definitely at the lower end of the spectrum when it comes to the emerging economies, the percentage of high growth companies in emerging economies. So that's number one and two. Number three, as I described, was the strength of institutions. It appears quite qualitative. It appears quite opinion-driven. However, what we've done is we've quantified it, and we've looked at how we compare across countries. And there's a surprisingly high amount of research on how strong institutions are. And what you'll see is there is a strong correlation between the strength of the institutions. As you go left to right, higher is better, and the corruption index in these countries. So India is actually roughly at the midway, right? So doing well, as you read in the papers today, improving over the last few years in terms of the competitiveness index, which is linked to institutions. It's also linked to the corruption index. However, again, a little bit of a distance to go. So these are the kinds of things that we believe directly help the competitiveness of the top 500 companies. More importantly, they create an enabling environment for their growth and the growth of smaller organizations. In particular, the kind of improvements is in the forward and backward linkages. Obviously, these 500 drive a lot of growth in the medium and the smaller entities. Secondly, improving the competition are in the ecosystem that surrounds them, and finally the partnership that exists between them and the tier one suppliers and the tier two suppliers and the wider ecosystem. So therefore, in summary then, you are a part of a very important component of GDP. If you were a separate economy by yourselves, it would be around the 25th largest in the world and growing to becoming the 10th largest by 2030. However, all is not right in terms of competitiveness. In order to fix that, we need more entrepreneurship, a higher percentage of high growth firms, a lot of which would be partners that you will create and you will nurture, and finally, stronger institutions. And the outcome of that is a benefit to the entire ecosystem and the economy. Once again, thank you for being here. We really appreciate the time that you've taken. Thank you for my two colleagues here who have taken time out from their really busy schedules at this time to be here with us. Thank you, sirs. And congratulations to everyone in advance who've won the awards for the top 500. Thanks very much.
Thank you so very much, Mr. Sinha, for setting the tone for the evening. And as I thank Sir, ladies and gentlemen, to now present the keynote address, I would like to request Mr. V. Vaidyanathan to join us. Of course, as most of you know, Mr. Vaidyanathan is the first managing director and CEO with having a unique track record of being a professional to entrepreneur and a professional entrepreneur. A round of applause for him, please.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's really a pleasure to be here this evening with every one of you. And it's really my pleasure to also have Mr. Subramaniam and Manish Sinha deliver this wonderful discussion where you presented lots of data and a lot of insights. And I look forward to hearing Mr. Subramaniam with his very insightful address about how he's going to change the economy of the country in the next 5 years. I can see him smiling. I made the same comment when sitting in the waiting room and he said it's above my pay grade. So let's wait and see how much we get from this new dispensation. I am very confident. Now, let me just start by saying that this is probably my first public address after the election, and I have to just say that how excited I am as an Indian to just see that we have a strong government that has come with absolute majority and which is undoubtedly going to give us a strong pro-market government, market reforms-oriented government in the next 5 years and beyond. The second thing that is important about the new dispensation that has taken over is that over the last 5 years, they have shown a remarkable degree of entrepreneurial approach towards government. And the finest example is what did GST. Now, what makes us even more excited is that the foundations have been built over the last 5 years. That's really very important. I do think that over the last 5 years, through a series of structural reforms, the foundations have been built, and I will talk about that. Fourthly, apart from foundations, the trajectory that is taking us into the future also look to be good. So when we put all these four pieces together, I have no doubt in my mind that the next 5 years coming in ahead of us is going to be very good. Now let me start with each one of them individually. Now, when we talk of foundation, when we say businesses, it should be easy to start businesses, it should be easy to run businesses, it should be easy to close businesses, and such that efficiency does get promoted. Now, as far as starting business is concerned, now all of us know that it has become it's become electronic, you can literally open companies online. Number two, the other foundation that has been laid is that to run organizations and the ease of doing business has dramatically improved over the last 5 years. We all know very well that ease of doing business for the country is around 73 or 77 now, and we look forward to touching below 50 as promised by the government when this ease of doing business came to 77 was announced. The third significant foundation that was put together over the last 5 years is certainly the GST. I mean, all of us have now have of course acknowledged and accept that it is one of the most important events that have happened in the history of our country economically. But when you look back and think about how rolling out GST was, it was really very difficult because we need to get the access or the approval of the lower house of the parliament, we need access of the approval of the Rajya Sabha, we need the states to cooperate. There were a large number of Indian corporates who were quite established corporates who said, we are not ready, we should push this back by another maybe 6 months or 1 year. You know, airlines companies came and said that GST is very difficult to do because, you know, our reward points are being paid all over the world and we don't know how to deal with this accounting treatment for the reward points. So basically even corporates were suggesting it being pushed back, but only a strong government which had an entrepreneurial zeal saying that, look, we will launch what it is and refine it over a period of time. That sort of took a sort of an entrepreneurial spirit towards governance. I think that as a result of that, GST did get launched. And of course, over many GST councils over time, they have been refined. But the point is that GST is a very fundamental foundation building block that is put together that will again help us in the subsequent period. The next thing is, of course, IBC. Closing of an organization. Now that was very difficult. We all know the promoters are having a whale of a time with this country. They had no price to pay for a company's going bad or business models going bad. That's gone. Now companies can close, and you can see how many thousands of crores have already been collected because of the new law of IBC. The other big thing that got implemented during this period was a direct benefit transfer. Close to about 6 lakh crores has got transferred to public accounts directly, bank account to bank account, and that has saved the country 1 lakh crores of ghost beneficiaries who were getting such credits in the past. Now, if you think about each one of these reforms, they are individually, they are definitely very powerful, but together they make an explosive combination of what it can do to the growth of the country in the years to come. Basically, it is making us more and more market oriented, which promotes efficiency, which promotes growth, and basically entities and companies can grow, they can perform, they can do well, and they can die if they don't do well. Now, this is on the big ticket reforms. The second part is the infrastructure that has got created for the micro level reforms, because when we see large corporates and we say reforms, that takes its own time to give growth, GDP, and that GDP to trickle down to the people. So apart from GDP macro trickling down, the other reform that is done is at the bottom of the pyramid, which is when we say that, you know, 72 million LPG connections have been given free to people. That is a direct intervention at the bottom of the pyramid. To open 300 million bank accounts is a direct intervention at the bottom of the pyramid. To do direct benefit transfer to public so that the NREGA payment and subsidies, etc., reach down to the bottom of the pyramid, directly to bank accounts is an intervention at the bottom of the pyramid. So apart from doing macro ticket reforms at the top, the reforms that have happened at the bottom is basically saying that, look, we can't wait GDP to trickle and people to have access to electricity and so on and so forth. Let us give it directly at the bottom of the pyramid is another important part of the reform. To think that, you know, India's all villages have got electrified now gives us hope that now electricity will not be available not to every village but to every household, and we can look forward to that kind of access and support that can happen. The other third part of the process or the digital infrastructure that has got created is again a very significant one, because apart from the fact that we have so many bank accounts, the 300 million that have got opened, we also have close to a billion mobile phones. We also have developed 4 credit bureaus in the country, and credit bureaus together have close to about 650 to 700 million credit lines, which is actually close to about 400 million unique customers. Now, this database did not exist. Now, this has to be seen in conjunction with bank accounts, in conjunction with having mobile connections. Then also India developed India Stack. Now, this sort of infrastructure does not exist actually anywhere in the world, to be able to wire money from a bank account of Bank of Baroda to another bank account in Bank of Maharashtra, bank account, 2 different banks wired just through mobile instantly. This system doesn't exist. I don't think very many Indians actually seem to appreciate it, that, man, we've got something so wonderfully different than the rest of the world. It is truly unique. It just doesn't go through a wallet where money lies idle. It is going bank account to bank account. Now, again, this is an extraordinary digital infrastructure that has got created in the country. Now, UPI alone, I'm not sure how many of you know this statistic, But last year in April, transactions through UPI, the one which I'm talking about, mobile to mobile direct, was 27,000 crores, which is itself close to 5-6-fold increase over the previous year, same time. Against 27,000 crores of UPI credits in April 2018, in April 2019, 1,43,000 crores has got credited through UPI. It's astonishing to think about what is the stage of, what is the extent of transformation happening on this digital infrastructure. Now, if this is sort of a transformation that has happened with the digital infrastructure that has got created, now we talked about the micro intervention at the bottom of the pyramid. Now, all of that can happen on this digital infrastructure. If this digital infrastructure did not exist, like one of our former prime ministers said, after 100 rupees, 15 rupees will reach. Now, 100 on 100 can reach because of this digital infrastructure. Therefore, when we look forward to the next 5 years of rapid growth, it is just not a hope. It is also because the architecture, both the digital as well as the road infrastructure, has got created over the last 5 years. Lastly, the total amount of write-offs or provisions, let me say, done in state-owned banks over the last 5 years is 8 lakh crores. I was astonished to read the number. 8 lakh crores of write-offs of provisions have been taken from the state-owned banks in the last 5 years. Now, we all broadly agree in the banking system that that phase is over, which means in the next 5 years, if we don't take those 8 lakh crores, which I assume we will not, then it means that there's that much more money available with the system, which can either be dividended back to the government or can be used for growth. So when we see the significant difference of what has been, let me say, cleaned up over the last 5 years, and then use that as a foundation to build the next 5 years, because of this factor we talked about, building of the foundations, we believe the next 5 years is going to be very unique. It's not unique because the foundation is being laid. It's also because between 2020 to and onward for the next 3 or 4 years, we are told that this government will have reasonably strong control or majority in the Rajya Sabha as well. Now think about it, a reform-oriented, market-oriented government standing on strong foundations with a firm drive to achieve something is also having, you know, control over Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha in a majority. I mean, it's a rare event that is coming in our country's lives, a really rare event. And I think it's, I don't know how many more decades India will have to go through towards getting that sort of unique combination. Therefore, for these reasons I talked about, I'm really looking forward for the next many years. I believe that this sort of intervention at the bottom will drive consumption, will drive demand, and the reforms at the top will drive efficiency, will drive growth, and together as a combination of investment and demand and efficiency and growth, I think we are set for a very amazing time. I believe that businesses should now look forward to the next 5 to 10 years with much greater optimism. It is not for nothing that the stock market have not stopped rejoicing ever since the results are out, or ever since the exit polls are out. It's been fully running. I think they haven't stopped rejoicing yet. It's not for nothing because markets can see that something amazing is going to happen in this country. I believe markets have still not seen what is a real opportunity. I think there is a big opportunity for growth of large businesses. There's a big opportunity for growth of the small businesses. There's a big opportunity for growth for the micro entrepreneurs, and for the micro entrepreneurs again will grow on the new digital ecosystem. So for these reasons, I really look forward to the next few many years, and I hope all of you feel the same way about our great country. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you so very much, Mr. Vaidyanathan. Like he said, we're looking forward to some amazing work happening in the country, and I think all of you are contributors to that. Well, this evening, we are honored by the kind presence of Dr. Krishnamurthy Subramanian, Chief Economic Advisor to the Government of India. And to thank him for his kind presence, I'd like to request Mr. Manish Sinha to please welcome him with a floral appreciation. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause as we thank, sir. Like most of you know, Mr. Subramaniam is a top-ranking IIT IIM alumnus. He has received his PhD from the University of Chicago's Booth School of Business. He and his research in banking, finance, and economic growth has been published in world's leading journals. Ladies and gentlemen, he has experience as a consultant to JP Morgan Chase New York, as well as a leader in iterative research groups in ICICI. You'll be happy to know that he is a regular columnist when it comes to various journals. May I request all of you to please put your hands together and welcome Dr. Subramaniam. Our guest here will be honored to hear from you, sir. May I request you to please address our audience?
A very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, let me acknowledge that I'm really honored to be amongst all of you. And let me start off by congratulating all those companies that are going to be awarded today for being in the top 500. As Manish showed with his very rich data and excellent analysis, that would do a lot of economists proud. It's not a very easy task to actually remain at that top level of being in the top 500 companies. So I think the heartiest of congratulations from my side are due to all those awardees tonight. I think what Mr. Vaidyanathan just mentioned is something that is very important for all of us to make note of. I'll take off from what he said and try and give my own perspective share what I think has happened over the last 5 years and what I see going forward. Let me start with one piece of advice, especially to market participants, having been on the other side and having looked to the bonus that comes at the end of the year, I can understand many times that market participants can be, a little bit shorter in their horizon, but it's important to, when you are reading the economy, to actually take a more long-run view. And I'll highlight what I've seen over the last two decades. There have been times, when I was in the United States and visiting India, where I would actually hear about how, the 9%, 8.5%, 9% growth is just here to stay. That period of irrational exuberance where, as if India doesn't have to do anything, and the growth will continue happening at that growth rate. And as we all recognize, oftentimes the seeds of a crisis are sown during good times because of such irrational exuberance. Contrast that with some of the pessimism that has been also going around, doing the rounds in recent times about the economy. I think it is important to have perspective, especially as Mr. Vaidyanathan shared. I'll take a few minutes to share with you that we all know very well that the dual balance sheet problem that happened, which was basically the ramping up of capacity and at the same time the winding up of corporate leverage that happened, and that happened over a period of 6 to 8 years. Now, I think we have to recognize that if the winding up of capacity and leverage happens over that period of 6 to 8 years, the winding down cannot be just instantaneous. It actually takes time. And therefore, the investment process, when companies are winding down on leverage, that is not the best time to invest. And, when you have built up excess capacity, that also actually means that the demand side of investment is something that takes time for the engine to get revved up. So that perspective is extremely important to keep on the investment side. Also on the consumption, I think what is important to keep in mind is that it's a tautology that, if you consume a little less, you are actually saving more as well. So you have to look at, both of those together, and investment cannot happen without savings happening. Another important point to keep in mind is that if you look at the consumption, There is, of course, those consumptions that actually happen because of sort of blips that come from in, you know, impetus maybe by a, given by a commission, or maybe you know, sort of corporates either giving discounts or increasing prices. What I think it's important to keep in mind is that the consumption growth that has been happening is actually driven by core consumption, and which is something which, you know, which sort of can sustain going forward. So these are just a couple of big picture points that I want to, you know, mention when we are reading the economy the way it stands today. Now let me actually, given, you know, I think the excellent presentation that Manish made, and actually so given the environment for today's awards, let me just share a few more thoughts for what we should be doing, you know, when we go forward. I think a key takeaway in the presentation that Manish made was that about 50% of companies, you know, are not there in the top 500 in, you know, within a decade, about 12 years approximately. What is very important to keep in mind here is basically the process of creative destruction, as Shimpeter talked about, and what we in, you know, in our own Indian scriptures talk about the role that Shiva plays in the holy trinity of Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, of creative destruction. So this phenomenon of actually about 50% of companies, you know, exiting from that top 500 group is that process of creative destruction. And here's where what has been done in the last 5 years, I think, is extremely important to keep in mind, which is the bankruptcy code. Because while you can have companies that are, let's say, getting out of the top 500, but if you have companies that continue to be living dead, then that consumes productive assets in the economy. And one of the key aspects of any market economy is that if you do not, you know, if you're not managing your assets well, then you have to cede that space to somebody who manages that asset better. And this is something which is very important. Related to it also is, you know, the another important statistic that many showed, which was on institutions and corruption. I think this is quite important to the process of basically productivity increase in an economy, because you have to have a situation where the assets that are actually managed are managed by people who are, you know, who deserve to manage, actually are the most productive in managing it. And that's where the process of institutions and corruption comes in. And here's where I think the focus that has been put on reducing cronyism in the economy, I think, is extremely important. The last 5 years, the emphasis has been on reducing cronyism. Without getting into specific details, I'm sure all of you would agree that, you know, a few years back, it would have been unthinkable to sort of see some of the big names actually, you know, being told to pay up or otherwise get ready to, you know, to sort of, as in Sholay, you know, said chakki pissing and peeing. So that's something which is basically was completely unthinkable. Or the fact that some of the, you know, the top, top names being told basically that, you know, aapka diwala uthai, right? And these are, I think, very, very important, you know, signals that we have to take into account, that because when you do not go and tackle cronyism in the economy, what happens is it is not the firm or the promoter that has the best ability to manage asset, but that particular promoter company that possibly has the best network, you know, to be able to reach out, you know, to the powers that be, ends up getting to manage those assets. And that in a market economy reduces productivity and thereby eventually impacts growth. So these two, which is, you know, the fact that there has been an emphasis on reducing cronyism by especially bringing in the bankruptcy code, Vedinathan talked about the GST, but I'm going to focus on these two because these are the fundamentals that, you know, for any market economy, ensuring that what we economists talk about as actually the matching of assets with basically who are managing those assets, that is indeed meritocratic. I think that is an extremely important aspect of any market economy, and the emphasis on that has basically created right conditions. Now going forward, of course, I think, you know, in my opinion as an economist, what I would say is that we need to be focusing on what I think about as the four L's basically, which is law, land, labor, lend. So law, land, labor lend. These are the key things that we need to be focusing on, because a market economy, the legal infrastructure, law, is basically what provides a bedrock through which transactions are done and unwound if need be. So that's really the bedrock. The other three that I've spoken about, which is land, labor, and lend, which is your, you know, lending or credit and capital, these are the three key factors of production. And that's something that you have to be emphasizing, focusing on, to ensure that the cost, you know, with all these three factors of production are reduced. Thereby, emphasis is placed on enhancing productivity by investing in reducing the costs of production. A final point I want to actually make is especially that these are awards that are being given by Dun and Bradstreet. Any market economy relies really on information. Information is that oil that actually fuels a market economy. And here's something, you know, what is important. When we talk about corporates, the first line of defense that an investor looks to is the financial statement. And the quality of that financial statement, therefore, is extremely paramount in being, you know, for investors to be able to judge and invest. So here's an idea for Dun and Bradstreet to actually start looking at, you know, also start thinking about constructing an index for the most, you know, transparency in the financial statements, or also start looking at an index of, you know, of auditors who actually are really doing their fiduciary duty of being the first line of defense in terms of financial statement quality. You know, have an index there. Let's have a competition, you know, to the top among those that are the first line of defense, the preservers of the quality of financial statement, because your market economy cannot work with high, you know, without high quality financial information. So that is something which is absolutely important. You know, I think you get the wind of what I'm actually talking about. But to me, that is extremely important if we really have to bring in, you know, foreign investment, because oftentimes the problem of asymmetric information, you know, is something that really spooks investors, especially investors that, you know, that sort of come from abroad. So just that thought for Dun and Bradstreet and other information intermediaries to actually think about to ensure that the first line of defense is something that is a watertight one. Once again, I'm really happy to be amongst all of you, and let me congratulate all those that are actually that are deservedly being recognized tonight, and I look forward to meeting all of you during the course of the next few years, during which I'm sure exciting things are going to happen in the country. Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much, Dr. Subramaniam. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, a round of applause for him. He mentioned how the road ahead, we must focus on the four L's, and of course, something that he just mentioned, which is how important financial statements are. And so taking from that is where our next segment is based on. Yes, it is time for us to showcase to you Dun & Bradstreet's publication, India's Top 500 Companies 2019. This publication, now in its 19th edition, ranks Indian companies on the basis of various financial parameters like income, net profits, net worth. It also contains an insight section based on an in-depth analysis of the financial companies and making sure how they perform. These copies will be circulated to various CXOs of leading corporations of India and, of course, to policymakers in the government sector. May I now request Mr. Sinha to please present India's top 500 companies 2019 to our special guest, Dr. Subramaniam, to release our publication. Ladies and gentlemen, a moment that we've all been waiting for. A round of applause and our dignitaries on the dais present to you 2019 edition of India's Top 500 Companies publication. I request all of you to please join us for a photo opportunity. Thank you so very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, it is an absolute privilege having sir here with us, and I would now like to request Mr. Sinha to please present the salver to Dr. Subramaniam. May I request all of you to please put your hands together as we thank sir. Of course, he'll be joining for a little longer, but for now, we'd like to take this opportunity to personally thank you. A round of applause as we present Sarva, Dr. Subramaniam. Thank you, sir, for your kind presence and encouraging words. May I now thank our dignitaries on the dais and welcome them to take a seat amongst our audience as we get our stage set for the next segment, which is a very exciting one and something that we've all been waiting for, the Corporate Awards, as we celebrate corporate excellence, ladies and gentlemen. This is a moment that all of us want to be here, known around the world for what we are best at. We truly are the stars when it comes to India Inc. I'd like to request our audience to bear with us a couple of minutes, and may I also remind all of you to please carry on with sharing with the world what you think about us. Use our hashtag and make sure that the social media knows that you're very, very active. Once again, as we get set for this very, very special part of the evening, it was no easy task done in Bradstreet, identified nearly 60 sectors in the universe of India's top 500 companies, such as banking, textile, telecom, and many more. The award winners and the team that we have worked through have been decided through Dun & Bradstreet's proprietary financial model, which identifies top performers in each category on the basis of a series of financial and non-financial parameters. This is the time that we introduce you to the real stars of corporate India. May I request all of you to once again put your hands together as I request our special guest, Dr. Subramaniam, to join us on stage along with Mr. Manish Sinha to present the first set of awards. May I request all of you to put your hands together, please. Sir has been kind enough. He joins us. First few awards. Thank you so very much, sir. Welcome once again. Well, we'd like to begin with and go on in the alphabetical order. And the first category of awards is agrochemicals. Yes, this is an industry where we truly are the breadwinners for our farmers. So let's get to know who is taking home this very proud trophy. May I request all of you to please put your hands together for our winners of this category, UPL Limited. A round of applause as I request Mr. Sameer Chandan, Regional Director, India, to join us on stage and accept the award. Thank you so very much and many congratulations. I'd now like to move on to our next category, ladies and gentlemen. But before that, I'd like to request all of you to please set a rule for yourselves. Each time we have an award winner joining us here on stage, we would love to hear your applauses. So may I request you to please put your hands together as we bring to you our next category, a round of applause for Alcobev as we present to you in high spirits our winners for this category, United Spirits Limited. A round of applause as I welcome Mr. Ajay Goyal, EVP and Finance Controller, joining us on stage along with his team, Mr. Divakar Witch. Please put your hands together as we say cheers to them. United Spirits Limited. It's now time for us to move on to our next category, which is that of auto components. It is the one that keeps the big cars running. So may I request all of you, please put your hands together for Bosch Limited. Ladies and gentlemen, joining us on stage to accept the award is Mr. Shailender Singh, Zonal Manager, Commercial Vehicles, Mumbai Zone, along with Ms. Priyamvi Mishra. A round of applause for the team here on stage. Next guy. category of automobiles, the sector which has been very, very competitive in taking home this award is a very special one. A round of applause for Maruti Suzuki India Limited. Ladies and gentlemen, joining us, Mr. Rahul Bharti, Executive Vice President, Corporate and Government Affairs. Please put your hands together for Maruti Suzuki. I request all of you to please put your hands together for Maruti Suzuki once again. It's now time for us to request all of you to thank Dr. Subramaniam for his kind presence. May I request all of you to please put your hands together and thank him. And to join Mr. Sinha on stage, I'd like to welcome Mr. Raj Kumar, Executive Director, International Operations, LIC of India. Ladies and gentlemen, our presenting partners for tonight's event is LIC, and we're so very proud to have them here on stage with us. So many, many congratulations, sir. It's now time to present our next award. So may I request all of you to please put your hands together as we present to you our next category, which is batteries. Let's charge up, and it's time for all of us to put our hands together for Exide Industries Limited. Please welcome on stage Mr. Subir Chakraborty, Deputy MD of the company, joining us along with Mr. Udhya Majumdar. It's now time for us to move on to our next segment, which is that of chemicals. So let us focus on that field. Please put your hands together because the strongest reactions coming in favor for Pidilite Industries Limited. May I request all of you to please welcome Ms. Apurva Parekh, Director, Pidilite. A round of applause for him, please. Say that all India needs is strong infrastructure, and that is what takes us to our next category, that of infrastructure development. May I request all of you to please put your hands together for Larsen & Toubro Limited. A round of applause for Mr. Vinod Chakko, Head Corporate Communications, joining us on behalf of the entire team of Energy to accept the proud award. Our next category is that of consumer durables and appliances. We know we want the very best for our homes. So may I request all of you to please put your hands together for Whirlpool of India. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Abhijit Sinha, Director, Regional Head for West, joining us on behalf of the entire team of Whirlpool. Please put your hands together. Many, many congratulations. Our next category is that of electrical products. And may I request all of you to please put your hands together for the company that has flawlessly presented the very best. Havells India Limited, Mr. Pankaj Russell, Vice President Head for Maharashtra region, joining us on stage along with Mr. Deepak Parmar. Many congratulations to you, Havells. We now move on to our next category, which is that of engineering projects and capital goods. Taking home the trophy is Siemens Limited. A round of applause as I welcome Mr. Harish Shekhar, Executive Manager Member, joining us on behalf of T-Siemens. Many, many congratulations, sir. Thank you. congratulations. It's now time for us to introduce to you our next category, which is that of fertilizers. And I'd like for all of you to please put your hands together for our winners, Coromandel International Limited. Please welcome on stage none other than Ms. Jayashree Sathagopa, EVP and CFO, joining us on behalf of the team to accept our congratulations and appreciation. As we congratulate ma'am, we'd like to now go ahead with our next category, which is that of financial institutions, NBFCs and financial services. And the winner is none other than Housing Development Finance Corporation Limited. Please welcome Mr. Prasanjit Gupta, Treasury, joining us on stage to accept the very, very proud trophy. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for him, please. We would now like to award those who've created a name for themselves in the fast-moving consumer goods category. And this is a highly competitive one. Please put your hands together for Hindustan Unilever, a brand that we all believe in. Please welcome on stage Mr. Prasadhan, Director, Sustainable Business and Communications, South Asia. What's up? Category that we are very, very fond of, at least most of us, which is food products. Please put your hands together for those who really do deserve this award. Please welcome on stage Team Nestle. Ladies and gentlemen, the winners, Nestle India Limited. We have with us Mr. Reggie Nair, AVP and Head West, joining us on stage. Taking the walk of fame is Ms. Raji. Many, many congratulations. Celebrate corporate excellence, it's time for us to move on to gas processing, transmission and marketing. And of course, we all know who's going to be joining us here on stage. Natural gas is indeed increasingly important resource, and joining us on stage, the winners, Gail Limited. Please put your hands together for Mr. Gautam Prasad and Mr. Himadri Mondal. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for them both. Before I introduce to you our next category, I'd like to ask all the lovely ladies right out here and the men who probably do some shopping, how many of you love jewelry? Can I see those hands up, please? How many of you love jewelry? And how many of you are forced to shop for those who you love? That's honestly fantastic. Well, that's the segment we're talking about next, gems and jewelry. And the question is, who's taking home this very, very proud title? None other than Titan Company Limited. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together as we present to you Mr. Koshi Chirian, the regional head, joining us on stage and accepting our congratulations on behalf of Titan. It's now time for us to move on to our next category, mining, metals and minerals. And here is one company taking it home, Vedanta Limited. Please welcome on stage Ms. Kanak Agarwal, CSR Communications, accompanied by Ms. Sunil Mattu. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for the team. Many many, many congratulations to you. May I request all of you to please get set for our next category, which is that for non-ferrous metals, and the winner is Hindustan Zinc Limited. Please put your hands together for Mr. Gaurav Sharma, Head Exports, joining us on stage along with Mr. Mukul Bedi, Country Manager, Exports Marketing. Ladies and gentlemen, it's now time for us to move on to our next category, oil refining and marketing. And may I request all of you to please put your hands together for our winners, Indian Oil Corporation Limited. Please welcome on stage Mr. Gurmeet Singh, Director of Marketing, accompanied by Mr. Sandeep Sharma, Head Copcom, joining us here on stage to accept the very proud trophy. All of you to please welcome on stage our next winners of the category Allied Sector, where oil and gas exploration, another capital intensive business, and the winner is Oil and Natural Gas Corporation Limited. Joining us on stage is Mr. P.K. Dilip, Executive Director. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for ONGC. As we congratulate our winners, I'd like to thank Mr. Rajkumar for his kind presence. And joining Mr. Sinha on stage is none other than Mr. Paul Jibir, CEO Randstad. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for Sir as he joins us on stage to present the award to our next category winners. Many, many congratulations to those of you who've already won the proud trophy. Our next category is in that of Eco Components, and the winner is Supreme Industries Limited. Joining us on stage is Mr. P.C. Samani, CFO. Please put your hands together. We also have Mr. R.J. Sabu on stage. Many, many congratulations. Ladies and gentlemen, our next sector is one of great importance to our country and any other, and that is power. May I request all of you to please put your hands together for those taking home the award in our power sector. And the company that has megawatts ahead of the rest is NTPC Limited. Please put your hands together and welcome Mr. A.K. Jha, CGM HR of NTPC. Joining us on stage along with him is Mr. Manoj Kumar, DGM HR. Many, many congratulations to the team joining us here on stage. We'd like to wish you the very best. DNB Corporate Awards celebrating corporate excellence here. Congratulate them. Keeping in line with our category is power equipment, and the company that takes its claim here is KEC International Limited. Please put your hands together and welcome Mr. Anand Kulkarni, Executive Director, Business Operations, joining us on stage along with Mr. Dibendu Ray. Please put your hands together for the team. Congratulations. Well, we are all heading towards a digital world, and that is what our next category is all about, software and business process management. And may I request all of you to please put your hands together for the ones who are best at it, Tata Consultancy Services. And joining us on stage, Mr. Krishnan Ramanujam, President, Service Lines, on behalf of the entire team of TCS. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause, please. And now we'd like to move on to our category of telecom equipment and infra services. And the winner is none other than Bharti Infratel Limited. May I request all of you to please welcome Mr. Vipul Gupta, Head Sales, joining us on stage on behalf of Bharti Infratel. Many, many congratulations. Truly deserving. I'd like to thank Mr. Paul Dupay for his kind presence. May I request all of you to please put your hands together for him. Thank you so very much, sir, for joining us. And now to give company to Ms. Sinha, may I please welcome on stage Ms. Jayanti, GM, and Ms. Gauri Rajan, GM, from the New India Assurance Company Limited to present our next set of awards. May I please request all of you to put your hands together for the lovely ladies. Welcome, ma'am. As we welcome both of them here on stage, along with Mr. Sinha, we'd now like to present to you our next set of awards, which is in the category of textiles. And the Scanner Textiles, the winners are Grasim Industries Limited. May I please request all of you to welcome on stage Mr. Himanshu Kapadia, Head of Qualcomm Grasim, joining us here on stage. It's now time to move on to our next category, which is transport and logistics. And this has several runners in the field. Ladies and gentlemen, taking home the very proud trophy is Container Corporation of India Limited. Please put your hands together and welcome Mr. V. Kalyanarama, CMD, joining us, along with Mr. Manoj K. Dubey, Mr. Sudhakar S. Chandran, and Mr. Alok Batkol. Please put your hands together for the entire team here on stage. It's now time for us to move on to our next category, and that is of iron and steel. Let's see which one is taking this proud trophy home, and it's none other than JSW Steel Limited. May I please request all of you to welcome on stage Mr. Shashagri Rao, Joint MD and Group CFO. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together as you welcome them on stage. Many, many congratulations. Thank you, ladies. You've been very, very kind. And as I thank both of them here, it's time for us to move on to our sectoral awards, where the industry leaders are to be facilitated. Yes, we now move on to our next category, which is the growth category. And here, companies showing consistent growth on several parameters have been recognized. Ladies and gentlemen, we are so proud to present to you our first category, Best Growth Performance Auto Components. And the first three special awards for auto components, the winner is Wabco India Limited. Please put your hands together for Mr. V. Ramanathan, VP OE Sales and Marketing, Wabco, joining us here on stage. Many, many congratulations to you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, I would now like to present to you our next category. And for this, I'd like to also remind all our guests to continue being active on the social media. You're welcome to click our winners, post them online using our hashtag as we present to you our next category. And the winner is Engineering India Limited. Please put your hands together and welcome Mr. Subhesh Kumar, General Manager, along with Mr. Prabhakar Sahu. Joining us on stage, Engineering India. Congratulations to them. Congratulations. We'd now like to move on to our award for Best Growth Performance. Yes, financial services and more. And data shows that best returns were from Bajaj Finance Limited. May I request all of you to please welcome Mr. Babu Rao, Director Legal and Head Counsel, joining us on stage from Bajaj Finance. Many, many congratulations to you, sir. May I now request all of you to welcome on stage those who are now going to receive the next award, which is the Best Growth Performance Power, and the numbers that really do light up Power Grid Corporation of India. Please welcome Mr. Sanjeev Singh, Executive Director, CMG, joining us on stage along with Mr. Sanjay Gupta and Mr. R.W. Wasnikar. Please put your hands together. To accompany Mr. Sinha here on stage, may I now welcome Mr. Nimesh Karavanian, the India CEO for the first Abu Dhabi Bank. Ladies and gentlemen, our partners for the evening, may I request all of you to please put your hands together joining us on stage. We'd like to extend a warm welcome to you, sir. And as sir joins us here on stage, the category that we'd like to move on to is Best Growth Performance Iron and Steel. Let's put our hands together for those who showed true metal. Mehta and Alloys Limited, please welcome Mr. Subodh Adwal, CEO and Director, joining us on stage. As we wish them the very best and move on to our next category, which is that of Best Growth Performance Metal Products. This is one that truly deserves all the accolades and more. Please put your hands together for Maharashtra Seamless Limited. Joining us on stage is Suman Mondol and Mr. Gautam Atta. May I request all of you all to please put your hands together as we welcome them here on stage. Wishing them the very best. And moving on to our award for Best Growth Performance Software and Business Process Management, and data points to a clear winner there. Tata Elxsi Limited, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and welcome on stage Mr. Hari Balan, Head of Com, right here on behalf of his entire team joining us on stage. And now, that we are moving on to a category which is beyond that of growth performance. We would now like to come to the last two awards for the evening, ladies and gentlemen. And these are some very special recognition awards. These are the awards that we look through, vision and more. May I request all of you to please share the excitement with us as we present to you the corporate social responsibility, a special mention there. The first of these awards is given to a company that has done very, very exciting and good work when it comes to corporate social responsibility, and it goes to none other than Tata Steel Limited. May I request all of you to please put your hands together for Mr. Jiren Jopno, Head of CSR, and Mr. Chanakya Chaudhary, Vice President, Corporate Services, joining us on stage on behalf of the entire Tata Steel team. And we hope you continue to do all the good work and create a difference. Thank you so very much. Well, our next award, or shall we say the finale award for the evening, is that of the company that has promoted Swachh Bharat and worked towards creating a difference. It goes to Oil and Natural Gas Corporation Limited. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome on stage Mr. P.K. Dilip, Executive Director, joining us from Team ONGC to accept this very, very proud recognition. Congratulate each and every one of you. I think this moment is one that we would love to capture in one frame. So as I thank all the winners for their kind presence, may I request all of you to join us back on stage along with those very, very proud trophies. We would love to have all of you in one big frame that we can capture. So may I please request all of you to join us here on stage. And we'll get the stage seated so we make sure that you see your brilliant smiles here. I'd like to thank both of you for your kind presence. Of course, I'll be inviting you back for the picture. Bear with us a couple of minutes, and I'd like to remind all our guests to please continue with your social media updates using our hashtag. There's a lot more to the evening, so I'd like to request rest of our guests to please remain seated. And a little later, we'd also like to welcome you to join us and meet all our partners. Their booths are right here, and their teams will be more than happy to have you. To remind all our guests that this is the first time ever Dun & Bradstreet Corporate Awards is being screened online live, and you can be a part of the celebrations and more on Facebook at www.facebook.com/Dun & Bradstreet India. We are also live on Twitter at www.twitter.com/DNB India. So I'd like to request all of you to please watch the awards and share the links with your family and friends along with your team, and of course share more and more of your thoughts on social media using our hashtag DNB Corp Awards. May I please request all our winners to join us here on stage along with those trophies. We want to make sure that we show them off in that great picture along with your brilliant smiles. Once again, I'd like to congratulate all the winners right here taking home the Dun & Bradstreet Corporate Awards trophies. I'll request all those of you right in the front to please take a seat. Some of you are welcome to join us at the back end. I'm sure we'll all squeeze in a way that we show our smiles and our brilliant trophies all in one frame. It's a very proud frame. our edition of India's top 500 companies, out with the star corporate performers right here. The evening has a lot more to offer, an opportunity for all of us to network, to know a lot more about our partners. They have their booths along with their teams right here in this very ballroom. You're welcome to have a word with them, know more about their services. And of course, do remember to take a recap of the event and the Dun & Bradstreet in your social media handle. The perfect smile is there on the count of three. So it's a 1, 2, 3, and let's make sure that this is the moment that we capture. I'd like to request all of you to please continue sharing your thoughts with us on the social media using our hashtag DNB Corp Awards. I'd also like to humbly remind our guests to share their feedbacks with us, because that's how we come up with a better edition each time. So I'd like to request all of you to please leave your feedback on the counter for us to come back with an even better next edition. Okay, let's rise those trophies higher. We should definitely be putting this on our social media. Once again, I'd like to thank you all and many, many congratulations. I'd like to thank Mr. Sinha and our partners and congratulate our winners. And as I wish the very best to all those who couldn't be here this year, we hope that the next edition has you. May I please request our guests to take a seat? We still have a lot more that we'd like to present to you this evening. May I please request all of you to settle down? Guests at the back end, may I request all of you to please take a seat? And now to personally thank all of you all for your kind presence, I'd like to welcome on stage Mr. Pankaj Khanna, Head Learning and Economic Insights Group, Dun & Bradstreet India. May I please request all of you to put your hands together as Mr. Khanna joins us on stage. A round of applause for him, please.
Hello, everyone. It is my privilege to propose a word of thanks at the conclusion of Dun & Bradstreet's flagship event, Corporate Awards 2019. This remarkable evening has allowed us to recognize the role of corporate India in spearheading the country's growth story. We all know that the top 500 companies contribute significantly to India's GDP, and as Dun & Bradstreet, we are confident that the role of these companies is taking India to the next level of growth. It is only fitting that I start my thanking our special guest for this evening, Dr. Krishnamurthy Subramaniam, Chief Economic Advisor, Government of India. It has been an absolute privilege for all of us to listen to his insightful perspective about the government's initiatives driving India's growth story. We thank him for gracing this occasion and encouraging us to aspire for a higher success in the future. We would also like to thank our other esteemed speaker, Mr. Vaidyanathan, Managing Director and CEO, IDFC First Bank, for sharing his thoughts with us. We would like to recognize our partners for the valuable contribution to today's events. Presenting partner, LIC of India, DIAS partner, IDFC First Bank, principal partner, First Abu Dhabi Bank, general insurance partner, New India Assurance, printing partner, Brother International, automobile partner, Mahindra & Mahindra Limited, workspace partner, WeWork, real estate partner, Sumadura Infracon, co-partner, UPL Limited, co-partner, Indian School of Business, co-partner, SAP Concur, and television partner, BTVI. I also take this opportunity to extend our heartiest congratulations to the winners of Corporate Awards 2019 and all the companies that have been featured in India's top 500 publication for their exemplary performance. Most importantly, the success of today's event is solely due to the august audience for sharing their valuable time with us today. We thank you for your time and enthusiastic participation. That concludes today's events, and we look forward to your company during the rest of the evening. Thank you.
Thank you so very much, Mr. Khanna. And once again, I'd like to thank each and every one of you. I think if it wasn't for this great audience, we wouldn't have had such a fantastic evening. So a round of applause for all of you all once again, and the entire team of DNB India. I think this is such a proud moment for us as we each year bring to you a new edition. I'd like to thank you all for making this, the 19th edition, so very, very fantastic, and I'd like to welcome all of you to join us for drinks and dinner. A humble reminder, we would love to hear your feedback, and may I request all of you to please share your feedback with us online. You're welcome to network with our partners and exhibitors. And of course, it's time for us to say cheers. On behalf of the entire team, this is Isha Bhalla welcoming you all to joining us for drinks and dinner. Thank you. ये नो जरूरतों को तेरी आगे मैं रखूंगा आगे आगे मैं रखूंगा आगे मैं रखूंगा For those who always put others first, here's a bank that puts you first. Introducing IDFC First Bank. Open a savings account and get